For coming. So today I'm going to talk about Quarkus bringing serverless to Java developers. So thank you for coming and welcome to this session. So I'm going to talk about a little bit more the Java developer perspective and also the brand new Kubernetes native Java stack, the Quarkus application framework, and how to build your serverless application. So my name is Daniel O. I'm working for Red Hat as the principal technical product marketing. And also, I've been a long time provide some the guideline and inspiration to how to build your cloud-native application development and also Agile and DevOps practice. So out of Reddit, I'm a CNCF ambassador. So if you are interested about the CNCF project, like Kubernetes and Prometheus and Envoy proxy, just let me know. And if you are interested about my specialty or Reddit technology, just follow my Twitter or you can follow my Git repository. So let's talk about some developer journey for cloud-native application development. So many years ago, maybe still some people still are living in there. So there were monolithic applications many years ago. So monolithic application actually are really cool because I've been a long time Java developer, more than 16 years. But 10 years ago, there's only one architecture, monolithic application. That application architecture contains 100% functionality and 100% dependency libraries. But there is a two big problem to maintain your monolithic application. So for example, if you want to change just a small piece of feature, you need to repackaging everything and retest everything, like a performance test, integration test, and also the regression test and interface test. All tests you should be done that everything. So that's why a developer gets started to break down your monolithic application application and small piece of a module. For example, a probe module and file upload module and also interface module. So based on your business functionality, the developer got started to break down your monolithic application to small module, just like this picture. But still, the developer have to packaging your entire module with a single application artifact, such as the Java technology. We can call that WAF file or EO file, and running on top of the big middleware. So that is the half solution at a time. So and that's why microservice was born. So microservices enables the developer to run your single module on top of the independent application runtime, such as Java, like Spring Boot, and Node.js, JavaScript, and Go, Python, Perl. So whatever you want, you can run your single module on single application runtime. And now we jump into the cloud. So you have maybe 100,000 microservices, and you can have multiple application runtime, like multiple application program languages. And now you need to run your thousand microservices on the cloud, which means your microservices are running on some network of services, like a distributed microservice, we can call that. And also, you might have multiple entry points. For example, from another the application API, or some web browser, or mobile devices, also some single small piece of the IT, IoT sensors. And you might have multiple data sources as well. So just 10 years ago, you have only the RDBMS to transact your data sources, but now you have multiple data sources like a data grid, in-memory data grid, or the RDBMS, and also NoSQL DBMS, even some just file. So now we are arrived in the function era. So from beginning monolithic application, now you have a distributed microservices running on cloud. Sometimes the public cloud and private cloud and also hybrid cloud. And now you have a function. So what exactly that mean, the function? So function means the you can understand event. So this is three pillars. how it works, you are the function as a service or a serverless platform. So there are already coming up some event from web browser, from mobile devices, or the other application APIs, and all event call map to a single function. And function call back to the back-end services. We can call that microservices or cloud-native application. So I have many chance to discuss about this journey and the serverless and also cloud-native application platform with many enterprise developers. And I always try to ask this question to enterprise developers. How do enterprise developers imagine the serverless computing? The answer is three things for developer perspective in enterprise companies. First answer is they don't want to worry about infrastructure in terms of how many CPUs, memory, network devices, and also storage. They don't want to care about that. Just the developed application like a Java application or JavaScript, and just upload the application artifact. And the rest of them will be processed automatically. And the second thing, expectation is auto scaling. So sometimes your application maybe has some seasonality capability. So maybe there are some rapid increasing your workload. Your application should be auto scaling automatically. And last thing is the pay as you go, like money. And this picture, actually, some people still compute serverless means there is no server in the room, but that is not true. Actually, there is a server full. So why the enterprise developer are thinking about that expectation? Because the Amazon Lambda make that happen. So actually, Amazon Lambda is really cool, and you can just the application, which means the enterprise company doesn't need to any operation team, just developer. And develop application and upload, and the other thing is boom, like a magic. But there are some big concerns. If you adapt to the managed service like Amazon Lambda to manage your serverless application, two big things came up. The first thing is multi-cloud strategy. More and more enterprise company jump into the multi-cloud strategy or hybrid cloud strategy. But if you adapt to just a single vendor's serverless platform, you cannot run your multiple function across the hybrid cloud and private, public, even on-prem. You cannot do that. And the other thing is more the developer point of view, you have some constraint about the dependency. So for example, if you adapt to Amazon Lambda, you just can develop just a few application languages like Java, JavaScript, something like that. But sometimes the developer wants to develop the multiple polyglot languages like Go, Python, Ruby, and Java, JavaScript. So there are two big things to when you use managed service. So how to solve this kind of problem? The answer is easy, managing by yourself. But some people worry about, is it really hard to manage by ourselves? But luckily, in the meantime, we have such a great technology, such a full things to make it easier, make it faster, and even no more complexity. So first thing, Linux containers, like from the beginning from Docker, but now we move forward to the OCI. So it's a more standard and format of container image. The container as a default provides you the portability and immutability to run your application across hybrid cloud. And Kubernetes is a de facto container orchestration platform. I don't want to talk about that. It's really pervasive in the world. And Istio Service Mesh is enable you to give some dedicated infrastructure, aka Envoy proxy sidecar. So based on Istio Service Mesh, you don't need to worry about non-functional microservices microservice capability, such as the smart router and the advanced deployment strategy, like a canary deployment and the blue-green deployment or A/B testing marketing stuff. And also, last thing is the API Azure service. In a modern application architecture, API is not an option. It's always the your application should expose your business functionality through the RESTful API. So this is a full new paradigm and technology make us easier to manage your serverless application platform. And let me drill down Kubernetes, how Kubernetes impact influence the serverless and function as a service world. So there's more than 13 serverless and function as a service open source project based on Kubernetes. So, but the fun fact, the Kubernetes is not easy for developer. So when I try to pitch this kind of the cloud-enabled journey for enterprise developer, always the maybe 80% of the developer told me, I don't want to learn about Kubernetes. Even some people said to me, what the heck is the Kubernetes YAML? I mean, it's a Java developer point of view. Maybe you, I believe some of you feel me, because the YAML stuff maybe some similar to JSON format. But one interesting example, one of our the customers, the developer, just changed the two line in a YAML file, and he takes more than 3 hours to figure it out what kind of problem, because there are some one space indentation caused the some error. So developer mainly doesn't want to run about Kubernetes, Kubernetes YAML file and some object, something like that. So that's why the Knave came up. The Knave, based on Kubernetes platform, and provide some kind of provide capabilities so developer can build, deploy, and manage your microservices or cloud-native application as a serverless workload. So here is the three primary component of the Knave: the build, serving, and eventing. So I'm going to show you a quick demo today about how do the Knave serving provide your the serverless capability based on your application. And one thing is notable, there is Istio service mesh is a mandatory component of the Knave. And build, so just imagine you are familiar with the Docker container. So if you want to create a containerized application, you need the Docker daemon. And we did some Docker CLI stuff, like a Docker build, Docker run, something like that. So Knative has the build features, which means it doesn't need to Docker daemon to build containerized application. And Knative serving provides some functionality to handle. So, for example, if you have any request during the time, your microservice application pod will be scaled down to zero automatically, just like the serverless mechanism. And eventing, some people wants to create a producer, some people just want to use the consumer. And the eventing enable their people to bind to the consumer and the provider. So I'm going to talk a little bit about Quarkus stuff. So what is Quarkus? Quarkus is the, we can call that supersonic subatomic Java. It's a Knave native Java stack, and you can use the OpenJDK JVM stuff, and also GraalVM, because if you use JVM, and you need to JIT compiler, and if you use the GraalVM, you can use the ahead of time compiler. So why I'm going to talk about Quarkus? Because there are so many challenges for Java developers because they have a monolith application or a microservice application, but they need to develop cloud-native application, which means more native on Kubernetes. And also microservice, even serverless, with the same application. And also, all Java application runtime were born for Kubernetes and container technology. So that's why always the Java application keep fighting with some optimizing performance and some memory footprint and small size file, even fast starting time. So that's why Quarkus was born after this technology and try to solve that kind of problem. So let me quick demo. Show you a quick demo. So one of the easiest way to get started to Quarkus application development, we have the Git repository here, github.com/quarkus.io, and there are this is a 100% upstream project, and you can click on Quarkus-quickstart. There are many practical examples, and here is the getting started Knative. I'm going to use this example, but I just a little bit tweak because I don't have enough time to show everything. So I already cloned my local environment here, just like Maven Java project structure. And I'm going to use the, you can use any the ID tool. So in this case, I'm going to use the zoom in. I'm going to use the VS Code. So once open your Maven project here, so Docker directory as a default and the Java Knative and the test directory. It's very similar. It's the typical Maven project. So go to the Java directory, and before that, I'm going to quick show you Palm XML. So here is the latest version of the Quarkus. We're going to release the 1.0 version late of September. And there are some dependency here. So for example, REST Easy, it means the exposed REST API and the unit test. And you can use the Quarkus Maven plugin, which means you can use the Maven command to build, package, and install. And here, interesting part is that we have a profile native. So native is we can use this profile, we can create a native image. So what is a native image? It's a curable image, it's a curable file, like a Go program languages. I'm going to show you that thing. So here is the greeting resource, the simple application example. Just the expose the hello and the return hello. So now I was a Java developer, and I already pulled some default application from scratch. And now I want to make sure if this default function is working. How to get started? The Maven compile. Quarkus. Dev. So Quarkus provide the development mode. So this is really cool. So I just already get started. We just need 1.3 seconds to start up and back to the browser. And localhost 8080. There are some the landing page hello and the exposure hello. Here is a hello. So just like this application is totally working now. And let's change the code, like a developer the life. So I'm going to change here the return code. Welcome devconf 2019. And I'm just save and back to the here and reload the page. Just already changed that. But I didn't even repackaging and rebuild. I didn't even restart my runtime. Just the automatically changed that thing. And we just needed here 1.6 seconds to reload that thing. So end of the day, this feature gives some developer increasing developer productivity. So I now let's say we complete the application development back to here. I just shut down, so the local environment is dead. Just make sure that. And next thing is we're gonna create the packaging file like a Uber jar. How to make it? Just Maven Green and package it. And I'm going to skip the unit test because the expectation of the unit test the return hello, but I just changed the code. So that's why I skipped the unit test. So already done here, we just 5 seconds and make sure the directory target. Here is our Uber jar. So running Uber jar is exactly the same, the Java interface, just target directory and running. But for that, I'm going to show you, so the memory footprint, if you use the Uber jar, so here's the the activity monitor in MacBook. So there is a 2 JVM already running. It's a background. So when I run here, okay, this one. Okay, just started, and we just need 0.7 seconds to start up, just super fast. And back to here, and the load the local environment is working, and back to the activity monitor. Here we go. Java, yeah, this one. So 99.4 megabyte. This is a real memory footprint, almost the 100 megabyte to run our the small piece of the Uber jar based on Quarkus application. And stop here. And next thing is the normally we're gonna containerize the application. Maybe there are two options: you could use Knative Build or Docker. But I'm gonna use Docker. It's more familiar with that. So, but for that, I'm gonna packaging using native image. I'm gonna show you what is the difference between JVM and GraalVM technology. So, just Maven packaging and using profile native. So normally it's gonna take just a couple of minutes to build, because during the build time, all dependent libraries will packaging in an executable file. It's that is a big different thing between JVM technology and also GraalVM, like a native image. So it's gonna take a little bit more time. So during the time, I'm gonna show you. Here is our Quarkus.io, our official page. So if you are interested about Quarkus, this is how to get started to develop your Quarkus application. So click on the get started. So here we'll get started your first application, build native image, and click on the guide. And there are some practical examples, such as how to create a core application, and the web application, and data application. And for example, here is the cloud section. Here is the how to deploy your application on Kubernetes or OpenShift container platform, and also Knative. So I'm going to use this example today, but a little bit change it. Align this demo. So back to the here, still working on that. And just one notable thing is when you build native image, that native image only can be running on the operating system or what you build. So for example, this is my local machine is a MacBook Pro, which means the here target directory we have here, learning image. But when you use the file format, so So this file format, the Mac OS, which means this the native running image only run Mac OS, which means you cannot run this image on Linux operating system. So I'm going to show you how to package the Linux operating system format, but for that, so I'm going to run this application executable image. Just target just get started. This is the Mac Pro, the security problem. This is a super cool. We just needed 9 milliseconds to run this application. Just imagine that. So your application, maybe you can package it with a JVM, or you can package it native image, but you need to run this application for your serverless framework and platform. So which one could be better to manage it on serverless platform? And back to the here, local environment, and running, load is totally working, and I'm going to split the terminal. Okay, this is the memory, the command is showing the memory footprint. This is almost 12 megabytes. So I already showed the EP using the JVM and the UberJA, you need to more than at least 100 megabytes as a memory footprint. But now you just need 12 megabytes, and you just need 9 milliseconds to start up. It's 100 times. Okay, and I'm just the native. So I'm going to read packaging here using the parameter, the native image, the .conf is true, which means I'm going to repackaging this application based on to run on Linux operating system. So back to here, it takes a couple of minutes, so it's going to be boring. So I'm going to show you a little bit interesting stuff, how to get started. The Quarkus application easily. So here is the developers.reddit.com/launch. So if you have some experience to develop Spring Boot application, maybe you are really love to use the Spring Initializer. It's a very helpful and practical to download the necessary the dependent library. It's a very similar, but more than that, because we support backend runtime, .NET Core, Spring Boot, Quarkus, and many application runtime. So once you click on start, and you can log in the free Red Hat developer credential, or you can use the below, you can sign with the GitHub or Twitter and LinkedIn, whatever you need. Just 100% free. And once you logged in, you can see there's three menu, get started, to create your application, existing application, or sample. So I'm gonna click on create a new application. There are three areas you can configure front end, like using AngularJS. Back end application, you can use the .NET Core, Node.js, Spring Boot. So I'm going to click on the Quarkus. And the beauty of this launcher, you can add back end application capability, such as you can add some basic CRUD capability, or you can add HTTP API. So once you set up, you can click on the download, but you can change the artifact name, like a DevConf demo, and click on download. And once again, now you download here. And next step is totally same. Just extract this zip file and get started application development using your prepared IDE tool. Okay, back to the environment. Yeah, just done. And make sure
file. So now you can see here. So Linux operating system, the format. So next thing is that we're gonna create container images. So before that, I already running my small the Kubernetes cluster. I'm gonna use a Miniship. It's all in an OpenShift container platform based on Kubernetes. So I'm gonna use our Miniship Docker environment first, and using Docker build. So here is our Docker directory. The Quarkus application framework provides two types of the Docker file. The first thing is a JVM. You can containerize the application using here the jar file and the native image, just like the runner image file. And there are the Knative directory. So this is the minimal version. That's why you can see just service YAML file based on the Knative serving using Kubernetes CRD definition. But if you download the Quick Start Knative, you can find more than that, like a service account and secret and PVC, the other things. Based on the default example using Knative build. But today I'm gonna make it quick. So I'm gonna use the Docker build. So I'm gonna create Docker build. In the service YAML file, we gonna use this Docker image tab. So we just done a Docker build. Just to make sure Docker image and reader. So we just building a Docker image. So next step, I'm gonna deploy this application using this service YAML. It's a defined Knative serving. But before that, I'm gonna show you the Miniship cluster. So one of the benefits of a Miniship provides the web console. So I'm using the OpenShift 3.11, but some people are already familiar with the OpenShift 4.1. So like I mentioned, the Istio service mesh already deployed here. So Paul already working on that. And here is the Knative build and Knative serving. In OpenShift 4.1, the Knative build, Knative serving, Knative eventing will be provided based on operator. The one notable thing is here is config-mat and Knative serving namespace and config autoscaler. And here we go. So it's a scale to down to zero, which means the if you have any request during this time, your application pod will be scaled down to zero automatically, just like serverless capability. So we're gonna I'm gonna show you the things also. So I'm gonna create the empty namespace. Quarkus on Knative demo. There is nothing in there. Back to the VS code. I'm gonna create the terminal and make sure OC get pod. There's no pod. And you can also kubectl. Kubectl get pod. So nothing in there. So I'm gonna deploy here, just to make sure of the current project, Kubernetes, the same namespace. So I'm gonna here the kubectl apply and this YAML file. Just run creating, let's see, yeah, automatically the application initialized. So back to the here environment. So pod is still running on that. So once running on that, I click on the here. And the logo file. And now you can see here. So 21 milliseconds to run. Because it's a little bit different, because the running time is a local environment. Just run, but on Kubernetes, the download the image and a little bit more spend time. So back to here, just to make sure functionality. Uh, So I'm just create the code script. Here we go with the same result here. So what is the code, the script? I'm going to show you that. So you know what? The Knave using Istio service mesh, which means the Istio ingress gateway as a default will deal with the all incoming and outgoing network traffic. So that's why I'm going to put in the ingress gateway service domain, and I'm going to call that things based on this script. Just keep it down, let it down. I'm not gonna decode this service during just more than 30 seconds. So let's see, scale down to the zero automatically. So back to the my slides there. I gotta have some couple of slides there as a takeaway today. Slow. Okay. So there are a couple of benefits when you're using Quarkus application framework and runtime for your cloud native microservice, even serverless application development. The first thing is developer Joe. You already saw that there's a library load just in a second and no configuration. This is really fun for developer. And second thing is just my t-shirt, supersonic subatomic. There are two things. Supersonic means fast, super fast, like the Queen's the song. And the subatomic is a very small piece. So here is the memory footprint, just 13 megabyte with GraalVM and OpenJDK 74. If you have a CRUD logic, still GraalVM 35 and OpenJDK 130, and the traditional stack is more than 200. And the starting time is a supersonic. You already saw that, just a millisecond to start up. And JDK, 1 or 2 seconds, just like Spring Boot. But yeah, still not good enough for your serverless application platform. And the other thing is the developer can unify imperative and reactive application program. So these days in enterprise environment, so the reactive system more and more popular, but problem is you need to develop reactive system in a different language platform, such as you just use Spring Boot like Java technology for traditional application like a service the microservice, but you need to some Node.js, Vue.x, the other some application runtime for reactive system. But with the Quarkus, you don't need to do that. Just the same application, but add the annotation. The left side, just inject. Right side, inject. Also, stream Kafka for reactive system. And last thing is you can use the latest open source project. We can call that the best of breed framework and standards. So here is actually we have more than 55.0 extension. So Vue.x, Hibernate, and you can monitor based on Jaeger, Prometheus, and you can deploy Kubernetes, OpenShift, and Apache Camel, Apache Kafka, and for integration and distributing system, and you can use the Infinity data grid. So here are just some resources. So I already published my article in opensource.com. It's a 3 series to how to build, enable your serverless platform based on Kubernetes, Apache OpenWhisk, and multiple open source projects. And the other thing is the how to build your Knave component, like a serving build configuration. And last Git repository, we have a Knave tutorial. You can use that. It's a for free, it's a very easy and you can learn that. So if you're more interested in Quarkus, there are Quarkus.io, I already showed that, and there are Julip chat, you can anyone can participate and ask any technical issue. And there are Twitter, you can follow on that things. And just back to the environment. Okay, here we go. So the all the container is already terminating, and back to the web console. Yeah, just terminating down to zero. In the meantime, we catch up the takeaways. So if I call that service once again, and back to the here, so the service automatically scale up like expectation of a serverless platform. So Knative make it happen. But problem is the you can use Knative on Kubernetes, but you need to pick one application runtime, which one is more appropriate for your serverless platform. So back to the here, and just the output is the same. And last thing is the, here is the YouTube channel. So we keep publishing video recording. It's just a 5-minute recording. I also created the Quarkus on Kubernetes recording. So just be sure to subscribe if you have interesting about Quarkus application. There are very practical and example, such as how to build application, how to deploy, and how to create the custom extension, something like that. Okay, I think this is done. So any question? Yep.
Hi, great talk. This is all
thank you.
Really interesting. And I think it'd be great for a brand new application, you know, greenfield development. But I have a monolithic application that's at least 12 years old, that's about 200,000 lines of code in Java, with a traditional deployment of a WAR file to an application server. And I'm wondering, are there any resources to help people like me migrate those 200,000 lines of code into Quarkus?
Yes. That's a really good question. So actually, many people ask me, we have maybe 1,000 monolithic application running on Oracle or IBM or the JBoss, but how to migrate to some brand new stuff? So actually, it depends on the complexity of your application, but we provide some migration tool. It's for free, the RHAMT, Red Hat Application Migrant Toolkit, but currently, it's they just provide some policy from the JVM, the Oracle and IBM on open source project, and we're gonna some plan to put in the Quarkus as well. So the way way how to use that tool, you can just upload your Java file or classes file, properly even artifact like a WAR file or a JAR file, and just check in some option like a package name or the target environment like a JVM 11 or JRE 11 or JBoss EAP coming soon in Quarkus. And the end of the result, they will provide the storing point. The storing point, which means the one point, is the kind of estimation 3 hours, 4 hours to migrate by the senior Java developers. So we are working on to provide that thing. But some people maybe need to rewrite, not migration, rewrite your whole bunch of application. It's a really good question. Thank you. Okay, I'm going to stick in around here. So thank you for coming. Thank you.